Okay, hello dear jury, dear audience, dear team members, dear guests. My name is Ivan Dimitrov. I'm from Team Bulgaria, and I will present our solution to problem number 14, GiHoWhoWhoWeDidIt. First of all, let's start with recalling the problem statement once again. A GiHoWhoWhoWeDidIt is a mechanical toy consisting of a simple wooden stick and a second stick that is made up of a series of notches with a propeller at its end. When the wooden stick is pulled over the notches, the propeller starts to rotate. Our task is to explain this phenomenon and investigate the relevant parameters. So, firstly, the structure of my presentation is the following. I will talk about the theoretical explanation of the phenomenon, which includes the motion of the nail and the motion of the propeller, which is caused by the motion of the nail. After that, I will present you our experimental setup and our experiments, followed by the conclusions, and show you the future sources of this. So now, firstly, let's start with the theoretical explanation of the phenomena. First of all, we will consider the following case. We will introduce a coordinate system xy, which is in the center of which is the center of the cross section of the notch stick. And so, by rubbing the wooden stick over the notches, we apply a periodic force in the direction. Here in this picture, the force is applied from the bottom. However, if we have only the stick will oscillate because of this periodic force we apply. However, if we have only oscillations in the y direction, if we rub on the bottom, we will not have a chance to determine which direction the propeller will spin. So, how we will fix this? We will apply our finger on one of the sides of the stick, and we will create another periodic force, which will have some phase difference with the force from the rubbing. And both of these forces can be modeled as harmonic forces, and we will write the total force in the x and y direction of the coordinate system we introduced, and they can be rewritten as periodic forces with some angular frequency. And this actual angular frequency is actually the time the period for this angular frequency is the time which a stick passes between two notches. This is the two upper segments of the notch stick. So, because this is a driven oscillator, the stick will once again undergo oscillations with angular frequency omega. And by applying some trigonometry on these equations, we can determine the phase difference between the two final forces, the resultant forces. And by considering different cases, if we have zero phase difference between the resultant forces, the stick will undergo linear oscillations. And if you have a phase difference of 90, degrees, and also both the resultant forces have the same amplitudes in these directions, the stick will undergo circular oscillations. And in the general case, when we have any phase difference in any and the forces are arbitrary numbers, the stick will undergo elliptical oscillation. This is the general case. So how will the direction of the rotation depend? These two pictures illustrate how it depends. This is simply because our system behaves as a harmonic oscillator in this directional model. The stick will undergo elliptical oscillations in these two directions, as seen on the pictures. However, because if we change the cross-section of the stick, if we apply the force to the same direction, its magnitude will not change. So, by changing the cross-section but keeping everything else the same, we will have no difference in our theoretical model and our experiments. So we will just make experiments with one cross section of the stick, which is the square one, because there the direction of the force is the simplest to make constant. Now let's start with the theoretical explanation of the motion of the propeller. The propeller will be driven by the motion of the nail, which will in the contact point between the nail and the propeller. This is when we assume that we have a constant contact point and we have the no slipping condition. The propeller will rotate around this point, and this point will also rotate around the ellipse. And so we will write the Lagrange equations here. And the Lagrangian of the system will be simply the sum of the total energies for the total kinetic energy of the system. And by differentiating by the three coordinates, where theta is the angle which the propeller has traversed, or its rotational angle, we can find the angular acceleration of the propeller. And it's the equation of the motion of the system is given by the final equation of the slide. So now I will continue with the experimental setup we used. First of all, we used a notch stick. We fixed it because if we move the stick, then we will not have constant forces, force amplitude in both directions, and we will also have the rubbing stick is also fixed, but it's held by a motor, and the rubbing stick we have this thing which acts as a finger. It always points in one direction, and this is to guarantee that our experimental setup is entirely correct with our theoretical model. And the motor pulls with a constant velocity, so that the period for the between two rubs remains constant throughout the model. And first of all, I will show you how the trajectory of the nail depends. So this video, play the video please, illustrates how the stick oscillates. We can kind of see that these oscillations are elliptical. However, once I put the video on slow motion and track the position of one of the points of the stick, I managed to find this trajectory, which is according to our theoretical model and experiments, an ellipse. So now, I will show you how the direction of the rotation depends on the position of the stick and the position of the rubbing. And these two experiments are the same direction of the rubbing stick and the opposite directions of the finger. And as you can see in both videos, the propeller rotates in two different directions. And this is exactly how we predicted by our theory. So now, additionally, we need to explain the motion of the propeller. So we will have to compare the angular frequency of the nail's rotation and also the angular frequency of the propeller's rotation. And we use tracker in order to average out the, in order to estimate the average period of one rotation of the propeller, and also one, and also the average period of one of the nail's oscillations. And so the results are presented in this table. And we use tracker in order to find how many frames, and after that find the period. And the experimental results for the both two periods are pretty close. However, the period of rotation of the propeller is a little bit greater than the period of nail's oscillations. That is because we do not have the ideal case, and there might be some effects due to friction and slipping that may increase the period a little bit. And now, as you can see, this is a simple demonstration. Once we start rubbing the stick, the propeller does not start to rotate at its maximum angular frequency at the very instant of when we start pulling the stick. And we will investigate how the angular frequency of the propeller depends on the time which it has elapsed. And we will use an experimental method to determine that, because our theoretical approach considers a no-slipping condition in every case, which is not the case in the initial moments until the propeller reaches the constant angular velocity. And I have taken the angular velocity omega of the propeller as a function of the time t in different time stamps. I use tracker in order to determine the angle which the propeller traverses, and after that I once again use tracker in order to calculate the angular velocity at every given moment. And I plotted the graphs on this table, and as you can see, we have approximately a linear dependence of the angular velocity of the time t until a point where the angular velocity frequency becomes constant with small periodic oscillations in the end. And so we will call this period of synchronization. We can assume that in the initial acceleration we have constant angular acceleration. And this is our driving angular frequency here. It's pretty close to the experimental measured one. However, it's a little bit different. So now I used Mathematica in order to evaluate this equation. And I have plotted the theoretical results for the same parameters of the propeller, which I had here, where the driving frequency was once again 32 radians per second. As you can see in the theoretical approach, this is after the period of synchronization, because, as I mentioned, the theoretical model only considered this case. We have pretty close to the driving frequency, with an average pretty similar to the experimental values. And once again, we have this small oscillation around the average angular frequency. And so now I will will consider the dependence of this period of synchronization on the different parameters of the propeller, which will, I will start with the hole diameter. And for the three cases, I measure the synchronization period. These graphs actually illustrate how our omega changes with different hole diameters. This is where we have all fixed parameters. We only change b. And I also found the dependence of the synchronization period of the moment of inertia, where we use the parallel axis theorem. Once again, I only change the dimensions of the propeller. I keep the b const here. And these two illustrate how the omega graphs depend on the moment of inertia. So now, I will, in order to find how the period of synchronization depends on these parameters, I plotted these logarithmic graphs. This is because this is in order to find the dimension, the dimension on which the period of synchronization depends. And from these graphs, you can find these final dependencies of the synchronization period of these two parameters. And I also made the same by altering the angular frequency of the rubbing stick. And once again, made this experimental logarithmic graph, and found the dependence on the angular frequency. So now to conclude my presentation, first of all, we have elliptical oscillations of the nail, which acts as a pivot point for the propeller. And the direction of the rotation of the nail and also of the propeller depends on the direction from where we press the finger and also the direction from where we rub. And we experimentally found that the propeller accelerates with approximately constant angular acceleration until it reaches the driving angular velocity. And this synchronization period depends on the various parameters of the propeller, which are its hole radius and also moment of inertia, as well as the angular frequency which is driving this motion. Thank you for the attention. This is the literature I use.
Calculations, you have assumed an elliptic trajectory of the nail.
Yes.
Is that correct? Okay. And how does your experimental apparatus create this elliptic trajectory? Where is the asymmetry?
Well, the asymmetry is that we press the finger from one of the sides.
Yes, I mean, I understand how you can create it with the finger, but then you have the experimental setup where there was a stick on top. Okay.
Yes,
can you show me a picture
yes,
of the setup?
A stick on top has a thing which acts as a finger fixed on one of its ends, and it points to one of the one direction of the stick, and is always pointing the same, which means that the magnitude of the force which will act due to this.
So you can always create an elliptic trajectory?
Yes, I always create an elliptic trajectory by pressing the stick on from one more side.
Okay. In your calculations, you have assumed a constant contact point between the nail and the propeller, is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, and so then do you have any explanation for why the propeller will start to rotate at all?
Well, the propeller will start to rotate. This is because initially the propeller will start bouncing, and once the angular frequency of the propeller reaches some point, it...
I mean, how the angular frequency of the propeller will get to that point?
Well,
theoretically... How the bouncing will...
When the propeller bounces, actually momentum is transferred to the propeller, and the momentum is always transferred to the direction of the rotation for the nail.
Okay, and do you have any calculations for this?
This problem is very hard to investigate directly because of the nature of the constant adding of the momentum. We cannot predict that this easily. And by applying this no-slipping condition, we can only determine the motion after the propeller starts rotating with a constant angular frequency.
Okay. Okay, so hello to you ladies and gentlemen. My name is Martin Marek. I'm from the team of Slovakia. I will be proposing problem number 14, genome in the middle. So first of all, let's go through the definition of the problem. We know what a genome emitter looks like, and we have seen videos of how it works. However, aside from explaining the phenomena, which they did to some extent in their report, also the reporters should have investigated the relevant parameters. And I think that this is a crucial part of the task. Maybe I would say that it is even a half of the task itself. And we haven't seen much of this discussed. They did have a rigorous experimental setup where they were able to replicate their measurements multiple times, which I think is crucial to solving this problem because it enabled them to remove the chaos of the human hand and to have these repeatable measurements. And they even were able to replicate these elliptical motions of the nail using a special touching point on that setup, and that they also did some calculations for the motion of the propeller. However, in this theory, what they have assumed is that they have a constant contact point of the nail and the propeller. And the experimental proof that they have shown us is, I think, well, there was a measurement where the speed of the propeller converged to the speeds that they theoretically predicted. However, what is not clear here is that how the propeller will start to rotate such that it will achieve that angular frequency. Because their only model is the final frequency, which I think is not really clear how is achieved. And I would really like to go through this in the discussion because I think it can be very interesting to observe how the different how the momentum will be transferred in the different possible contact points of the whole motion. Also, they have assumed elliptic motion of the nail, and that has clearly worked quite well because clearly for an elliptic motion of the nail, we will see the propeller rotate quite fast. However, when I think about it, if I can make an elliptic motion using my hands in one direction and then also in the other direction, I should also be able to create a linear motion with my hand if I let the finger be somewhere in the middle. And I would be interested in knowing whether this could somehow resemble the problem where we don't have the constant contact point, where this could perhaps resemble the problem of simply the propeller bouncing. I do not know, but I think that this would be interesting to know, and perhaps we could go through that in the discussion. Also, it was not completely clear to me how they have derived the ellipticity of the motion. Perhaps you could go through that. And also, some of the graphs were not quite so clear to me. We will go through them. Toward the end of the presentation, there were a lot of points and a lot of graphs, and I couldn't really grasp all of the ideas that were presented. So, in the discussion, I would also like to go through perhaps some theoretical predictions of what these parameters could do. I think that there's lots of them. I've only named a few of them. And I think that what this could do is that perhaps there wouldn't be a stable, constant propeller frequency for each of these combinations, such as if I choose too large a hole, too small a nail, and an amplitude that is simply not fit, perhaps I will never be able to start the propeller to rotate. So I think we can go through this in the discussion, which I would like to start right now. Where do we begin? Can we go through, have you ever observed a linear motion of the nail?
Yeah, we can observe a linear motion of the nail if we don't have the finger pressing on the side.
Okay, and what happens then?
Well, then the stick just oscillates up and down because we rotate from the other side. However, in this case, we cannot predict in which direction the propeller will start rotating because it depends on its initial orientation.
Okay, but you're saying that the propeller will start to rotate?
Yes, it will start to rotate at some point because once some momentum has...
Feel free to wipe the names off.
Shall we? Shall we go through this? I mean, do
well.
Do you have any explanation for it? I mean,
yes. When we
can I what?
Yes,
more?
Please.
Okay. So please take a marker and.
Because initially the propeller for the starter rotate must be a little bit, it is a little bit off center on the nail like this. And it's got oscillations in the upper direction. Some momentum will be transmitted in this direction. However, with it, the propeller is a little bit inclined. So once the stick reaches this direction, some momentum will be transmitted once again to here, and the some of these two impulses will result in an impulse which may bring the propeller to the side. This will happen at some point.
Okay, but like, why won't we then see oscillations that will move the propeller or will push the propeller in the other direction? What is the stabilizing effect here?
The stabilizing effect here is a little bit unknown. This is because everything depends on the position of the propeller relative to the motion of the nail, because once the momentum is transferred, it just creates this impulse, and the propeller starts moving in this direction.
Okay. Well, so
the position of the propeller is the measuring factor here.
Okay, so it's fairly complicated. Right?
Yes, it is. It's fairly complicated motion, and if you have elliptical trajectory, the impulse is given to this direction, then to this direction, and the total sum of these impulses will make the propeller.
Wait, but I mean, if we have elliptical motion, then also we have some. There will also be contact in the opposite, on the opposite direction, right? Can we see a video where we see the propeller start to rotate? Do you have such a video?
I have one of those videos. So yes, this slide 16. It's not clear still because the hole cannot be seen from here.
Okay, so this demonstration.
So I'm sorry.
Okay. And do we, for example, know what kind of effect friction plays here?
The effect friction plays here is once again pretty complicated.
Okay, but if we simplify, like, we need friction for the propeller to start to rotate, is that...
Yes, if we have the constant contact point, that means that we have no tipping position, and the propeller rotates, and then we have rotation.
Okay.
It's just because the propeller rotates.
Okay, that is interesting, thank you. And perhaps, well, now that we have a model that is capable of predicting the stable frequency of the propeller that you can reach, but are there any cases where, due to some reasons, we cannot really reach that stable frequency?
Well, I have not investigated it, but I guess that when the hull is too big, it may play a role because it will not always be in contact with the nail, and it will start jumping.
Okay. Also.
Also, if the hull is too small, we will need a lot of time for the propeller to synchronize, because as I explained, we investigated the synchronization period based on the hull diameter. And if you have smaller hulls, this period increases very dramatically. And so if you have too small of a hull, we may not observe anything at all because of the instability that we have.
And did it happen to you that you had a combination of a stick and a propeller that you wouldn't be able to start?
No, in all of our cases, we made such propellers that the hull diameter is around 2 times greater than the diameter of the nail. This is just from the paper we took our literature from. They consider such cases, and they said that in this case, we will have an optimal motion.
So a paper says that we reach an optimal motion when
if the hull is too small, in the paper was proven that if the hull is too small, that we may not observe this this constant angular frequency at some point.
Okay. And so do we know about the other
possible? The nail size, it's actually important to consider both hole and nail size, because if we have the same hole and increase the nail size, we'll have different ratio, and we must consider these two parameters at the same time.
Yes, yes, of course.
So so we can just consider the hole size, and the nail size we will follow through. And I have made altered the hole size, as I said.
Can we see that? I mean,
yes, I have experiments for different hole sizes.
Okay, can we see the result?
Yes, so I made for several hole sizes, at least five. However, I found how long the synchronization period was for each one of the hole sizes, and the greater the hole size, the lesser the synchronization period was.
Okay, and what do we see here? What are these different series of points?
These different series of points are actually the angular velocities, oscillations around the mean value. And as you can see, if we have a great if we have a less than a hole, it will be a little bit more stable.
Why is it like two series of points?
No, it's not
two clusters.
It's not two clusters of points. This is because the points are very close together. It's actually like this.
Okay. So
it's approximately
sinusoidal
motion.
And is it correct that the frequency is really over 100 hertz?
Yes, we use the motor in our case, and the motor pulled very fast.
Okay.
And the cold pulling was made in a fraction of a second.
That is quite fast. Okay. So now, what is the conclusion here?
The conclusion is that if you have a less hole diameter, the greater the
And what was the diameter of the nail here?
The diameter of the nail here was 1.5 millimeters.
Okay, and if we try to approach that closer,
the period will reach a value of infinity at the last point. It will have an asymptote over.
Okay. And so here, are these the predictions?
No, this is the experiment in measures average.
Okay, and do you have the predictions of your model here?
The predictions of our model, I made them on the other sample.
No, I mean like here.
For these experiments, I don't have them because I already showed a theoretical prediction compared to the experimental data. This is the result of our theoretical simulation. The yellow line is the theoretical.
But this is one experiment, right?
Yes, one experiment. However, it's enough to prove that that our theory matches the experiment.
But this is only. Okay. Well, your theory doesn't include most of the parameters.
Well, it does include the hole size. It includes the Stick's moment of inertia, which is connected to its thickness. It includes the frequency.
I have also
investigated this.
But how do I know that it will match as well as this for the other measurements?
Well, this is because we made the experiments with the same setup, and we made the simulation by solving the differential equation. So just by altering the parameters and using the same setup, the prediction from the differential equation should be the same, because we have the same line.
You're able to create different frequencies of the propeller.
Yes.
So for the different frequencies of the propeller that you created, can you show me different frequencies that you have expected using the model?
No, I just used this for demonstration that our theory quite well matches the motion of the propeller after the synchronization stage.
Okay, well, thank you. I think I will have to move to the conclusion now. It was a very interesting discussion, but I think, for example, that even though that the fit was almost perfect for the one measurement, it is not very good that they haven't included more measurements if they have such a complex theory. And for example, for the motions where we have seen a frequency of the propeller over 100 hertz, I would perhaps like to see how well we can fit those. So I would like to have seen more confirmation of your theory. That is also to know something a little bit better about these parameters. Also, I think what was lacking slightly was that we don't really know why the propeller starts to rotate. And what the reporter confirmed is that the propeller can also rotate if we have linear motion of the nail, which wasn't mentioned in the report. and I think that this could as well be interesting, and at least it could have been experimentally investigated, if not theoretically. So thank you for attention.
afternoon, dear judges. I'm the reviewer from Team Cloudline, and I'm going to review problem number 14, Jihao Wellin Dido. So this is the problem statement. The problem statement is going to talk about when we have a wooden stick fall over the notches. We have to explain the phenomena of the propeller depends on relevant parameters. So this is the reporter's outline. First, he showed us the theoretical explanation about the motion of the nail and propeller, and he has a detailed illustration of the pictures, but he didn't have a very clear observation video that we can obviously see that the motion of the dido. And second, he told us about the experiment setup, about the device to fix the dido, and we think this is a very well device, but however, he wrote by his hand, and we think that it might have a little bit arrow. And his reference is he considered many reference, but he didn't have his self thoughts. And for the experiment part, he has many parameters like the velocity, annual velocity, the hole diameter, and the hole size. But he is lack of simulation, and his experiment chart is hard for us to understand. And for the conclusion part, he said the oscillation of the nail is caused by the rubbing. And for his observation, he gave us this kind of the propeller, and we think that there is a big boat in front of the pivot that we can clearly see the motion of the pivot. Is it moving like circle or something like that? And for the first class, they discussed about the oscillation of the pivot. And the opponent asked about if the oscillation will cause the rotation of the propeller, and the reporter agreed, and he said that it will cause by the friction. And we think that we agree with the reporter that it will cause by the friction. Or however, he should also consider the torque caused by the normal force. And for the second one, the clash, they talk about the linear motion of the pivot. And the opponent asks about when will it occur, like the motion like linear motion. And the reporter said that not using his finger, and it will occur like the linear motion. And the reporter disagreed with the reporter. And we think that if you incline the stick, and it will also produce a force on the x-axis, which will also make a linear motion. And for the third one about the big hole condition, the opponent asks about the hole size, whether it will affect or not, and what will affect when it's bigger or smaller. And the reporter said that when the hole is bigger, it will have no slick condition, which will cause the instability. And we agree that we can't use the no slick condition, but however, we are quite confused about the instability and also whether the no slick condition can use in every size of the hole. And they also discussed about the setup, whether the reporter did the set, how did they do the setup, and also several parameters that the reporter can have a further investigation, and also they talk about angular velocity. So that comes to the point missed, that the reporter should did more about the no slick condition because they didn't observe this motion more, and they did not define the synchronous period. And we think he should do this more because we can see on his graph the angular velocity will increase linearly, and we don't know why it's nearly. So I think that the reporter should explain more. They didn't explain why there is a phase difference. And for our conclusion of the reviewer, we think no slick condition should be suspect in every experiment, and we still think that phase difference is caused by the beta, which is the coefficient of the damping coefficient on the x and y axis. Thank you.
Okay. So first of all, I would like to address some issues that I found in the discussion. First of all, the opponent asked me about parameters I have already explored. He asked me about some parameters of the propeller. And all of these parameters can be summarized in one thing. This is the moment of inertia of the propeller. And I explored the dependence of the synchronization period on the moment of inertia of the propeller in my presentation. So the reviewer said that, can you please return your presentation? Well, it doesn't matter. So I think that the reviewer didn't quite catch what was discussed in the discussion, because we investigated this motion, which is caused because she said that if we remove the finger, elliptical oscillations may occur. Yes, they may occur. This is because if we incline the stick to an angle towards the x and y axis, this means that the force, the absolute force, will be split between the x and y axis. And we once again have two harmonic oscillations in both x and y axis. And this is why we also will have elliptic motion in this case. And depending on the angle, the amplitudes of these x and y components of the force will be different, and so the ellipse will have different parameters. Yes, firstly, this simulation, this illustration of the video where I rub by hand, this is to achieve small angular velocity, because we used a drill as a motor, and this is to explore the dependence of the rotation when you have very large angular velocity. Those 600 radians per second cannot be achieved by just rubbing our hand. And so in the first simulation, I used rubbing by hand, and this is why we have this the data for this experiment is not wide clear if it's a linear dependence.
Can we have a tribute to the front of them, please, so that judges can ask questions? Judges, any questions you have?
Okay, I just want to ask, because you had quite a lot of graphs.
Yeah.
The one with three, graph 1, 2, 3, we had all the points there. And then later on you were saying that actually they are meant to connect.
Yes, that just
can
that's
you
just
clarify a bit more.
This is just because I used too much, because our angular frequency with which we use when we use the motor is very high. And the points for a given time period, there are a lot of points. And these graphs I did not make them quite clear enough. I should have used a smaller time interval in order to show you the oscillations of the angular frequency around the stable point. This actually happens.
Can
I
you
can
bring that graph up for us, please?
I can show you. I can edit the graph in order for us to in order to show you. That would wait. Do you want me to edit the graph for a short time?
Just to bring it up.
You talk about this slide or the previous? It's quite the same.
Okay. So what you're saying is that the angular velocity is going from 750 to 600 radians per second in a very small amount of time?
Well, yes, and this is actually predicted by our theoretical model. We have oscillation around the mean angular frequency. And this is just our experimental data, so I have to agree with this. It may be caused by some errors in our device, however, I don't think so, because in these two cases, we can clearly see that it goes downwards and upwards. And this is a constant factor. This is because we have sinusoidal like oscillations of the angular frequency.
Okay. And the opponent, would you like to comment on that? Do you think that's a sinusoidal type oscillation, or might there be another effect?
What is not very clear to me is why there are like two clusters on the chart down there. I'm not sure why that is, but their model does predict the sinusoidal change in the frequency.
Thank you, Dan.
Can I ask a question to your results? What is the meaning to state the mean frequency to seven places if the frequency changes of about 100 radians per second?
This is just because I measured all of the angles to the four digits and just formatted like that. We do not need this high of an accuracy because of...
So there is no error in measurement?
Yes, there is error in measurement. However, we can calculate it by applying some standard deviation here. However, we should be probably considering only the first three meaningful digits, which is only the, without everything from the point.
Okay.
decimal.
Okay, question to reporter. Could you explain again that why the angular frequency saturates? I mean, why the net force becomes zero after some time?
Why it becomes?
Yeah.
Well, this is the.
Do you have any theoretical explanation?
The theoretical explanation for the entire acceleration of the propeller is pretty complex to be considered theoretically. However, I guess that at some point the propeller will start moving in the same direction as the nail, and they will both like collide with each other and start rotating both at the same time. I guess it will be something like this.
And a question to the reviewer. You mentioned that the normal force from the pivot to the propeller, that may affect the force.
Sorry, Ginger. All right, thank you very much, everyone. Judges, I'm powerless. 4, 6, 6, 6. And to the opponent, scores are 6, 6, 7, 6, 8. And lastly, for the reviewer, the scores are 7, 7, 7, 6, 7. The scores for the report are pretty homogeneous. There's just a four people, if you like to just speak to that quickly, please.
I just struggled with the laptop. Okay, I struggled a lot. Yeah, I know that your experiment, you have a lot of passion and experiment, you really thought about it. But I really struggled with the laptop. So, all that 15 of them.
Okay, with regards to the opponent, they were named 6s, 7 and 8, so yeah, just the 8, please.
Yes, I was delighted that they stated that the model was not perfectly what was the task. There was a rust finger, and there should be this, how is it described? Service of notches instead of finger, and also I've decided for 8, probably an 1/2 of point above mean of this commission.
Okay, and for the review, incredibly homogeneous 6s and 7s, so that's fine. Congratulations, end of stage 2. So again, if we'd like to take a